Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Glory to the name of the Lord. God, we give you glory tonight. Lord, we honor you. I want you, if you could, just to remain on your feet and lift your hands up to the Lord. That song says, Jesus be the center. Lord, we give you glory tonight. We thank you, Father, that you are the center of all of our affection tonight. God, that all of our attention is on you tonight. Lord, we pray tonight that your name would be magnified in this place tonight. God, I pray that your power would be manifest in this place tonight. Lord, we pray that the name of Jesus would be exalted tonight. We come against every demonic opposition to your will and your purpose tonight, and we bind it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ tonight. And God, we thank you that deliverance and freedom and healing and restoration will flow freely in this place tonight. God, we thank you that in this atmosphere tonight, that every need be met. God, that every need for deliverance be met. God, every single need for restoration be met. Every single burden be lifted in this atmosphere tonight. God, delivering power and healing power would be manifest tonight. We give you the glory and the honor and the praise tonight. For we thank you, God, tonight that it shall be so. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I thank the Lord tonight. I welcome him. We know that he's here, and we know that he is always present. But we're asking him tonight. Each person need to ask the Lord tonight, Lord, reveal yourself to me. Don't let just the person next to me experience your presence, but God, reveal your presence and your glory to me. Lord, I ask you tonight for each one that's in this room tonight, God, that you would cause there to be tangible encounters with the glory and the presence of you, the living God. We pray, God, tonight that no heart would be left unchanged and untouched tonight. Lord, we pray that conviction come through the Spirit of God. We pray tonight, God, that your will be done in this place. We give you glory tonight. We thank you, God. We celebrate 1 year. We thank you, God, for it was your grace and your mercy that has brought us this far. We don't take it for granted tonight. So, God, we will, as that flyer said, we will turn up the praise tonight. We will give you praise. We'll turn up the prayer tonight, and we will give you the glory, for you are worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. All God's people said amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. You can go ahead and be seated. Just continue to stay in that spirit of prayer. Just play a little bit there. I'm honored to be here tonight. I pulled up into the parking lot along the street, and I felt God. Have you ever felt God somewhere? You just know that he's there. And I felt God, and I felt at home, even though I come from Ohio, which is about 8 hours away. I felt like I was pulling up at the lot at Hope City on a Friday night. We have service every Friday night, and we have just a room full of young people usually just praying and asking God to move. And I felt that same sense of God's presence tonight when I pulled up. And one thing I learned, that just because God is there, we should not take that presence for granted. It's a blessing that God is here tonight. It is a blessing that God is here tonight. It's a blessing that his presence is not just here, but manifest. So tonight, I want to give him maximum glory. I want to give God maximum glory, all the glory that he's worthy of, and that's due to his name. I'm so grateful to be here tonight. It's like a home away from home again. Pastor Carl is a dear brother of mine. We've known each other for about, 7 years or so. We met, I think, through Facebook. And then real life encounter after that. But just watching, again, the grace of God at work in his life, watching the story of the Voice Ministries unfold from the prayer, from the word, the revelation, the prophetic word, the step of faith, the obedience, the manifestation. I remember when he was believing God for this very building. Some of y'all don't maybe know that story, but I remember we were praying and asking God to give us this building and to come here just in 1 year and to see this room full of people that are filled with the Spirit of God. To see this place full of worship is the answer to prayer. So I thank the Lord that he hears, not just he hears our prayer, but he answers our prayers. Amen. Amen. Again, and I greet you from Columbus, Ohio, the capital city of the great state of Ohio. And I come to you with joy in my heart. The Lord gave me a word for you, and I'm here on a threefold assignment. All right? Are y'all with me? People in Ohio, give a little bit more feedback. In Delaware, give a little feedback. Y'all with me tonight? Just humor me if not. But I came here on assignment, and this is a serious night. The Lord I don't know if it was when I crossed the state border coming into Delaware, but you know that there are powers and principalities that govern regions. And you can sometimes, if you take one of those long journeys, today I crossed through Pennsylvania, I crossed through West Virginia, I somehow got here to Delaware, and I could even feel in my spirit a shift. And when I crossed over into Delaware, it was like the burden of the Lord dropped in my heart. And do I have any intercessors here tonight? When you're an intercessor and you really walk with God, you begin to pick up on how God feels about even the place that you're at, whether it's a building, a city, a state. And as I crossed over into Delaware, the Lord just began to burden me for the state and for the people of this great state. And so I'm coming to deliver a word to world changers tonight. So I come here on a threefold assignment. My number one assignment is to affirm this ministry and our dear brother. Can we put our hands together one more time for your pastor, Pastor Carl Wright? Come on, we can stand on our feet and do better than that. Come on, stand on your feet if you're thankful for his labor of love. I gotta shake your hand. Amen. But I'm here to affirm him. Affirm him. We need affirmation. We need affirmation. My second reason for being here tonight again is to proclaim the word of the Lord to you. To proclaim the word of the Lord. The Lord, he says in his word, it says that man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of his mouth. And if Delaware is going to live, Delaware is going to have to hear the word of the Lord. If this ministry is going to live, this ministry is going to have to hear the word of the Lord. If you are going to live, you're going to have to hear the word of the Lord and mix that word with faith. So I have a word from the Lord to proclaim. And then thirdly, I'm here to rescue. Now, I'm not the one that can save you, but I'm here to throw out the lifeline. The Lord told me as I was even driving up, there are people even in this room tonight that are not saved. Uh-oh, you're not supposed to say that on the first anniversary service. But you know that it's the mercy of God to draw people. It's his goodness and his kindness that draws us to repentance. And so what I'm here to do is to rescue you through the word of the Lord. When the word of the Lord comes to you, it pulls you out of pits. It pulls you out of situations. It pulls you out of mindsets. It pulls you out of unbelief. And some of you you're saved in the sense that you are in the kingdom of God. Your name is written in the Lamb's book of life, but you have not gotten into agreement with God's purpose for your life, so you are self-destructing. But tonight, I'm believing that deliverance can flow in this place tonight. And I'm believing that the Lord can come and snatch people up out of that miry clay. Amen? Amen. So as we go to the word of the Lord, let's say a word of prayer. Father, we ask you in the name of Jesus for the unction of the Holy Spirit. Lord, in this place, God, we know, I recognize, God, as just a man that I have nothing to offer. God, that I can do nothing apart from you. So, Father, I ask you for the anointing to come upon me as I preach your word. God, I ask you that the ears of your people would be attentive and that they would hear what the Spirit would say to the church tonight. We give you honor and praise, for your name is worthy. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you, Brother Donovan Butler, another Columbus, Ohio product. Let's give it up for the worship team. Brother Butler, my man. Amen. Tonight, again, we're here to celebrate, to turn up. Turn up. And is that a phrase that they use in Delaware? I don't know. I mean, I don't know what crowd I'm talking to tonight. But back home, when you say turn up, that means you don't just sit there looking cute. I don't know. I mean, maybe when you were in the world, you used to turn up. But now you come to church, now you want to be all quiet and holy. But listen, you ain't got to be quiet to be holy. Last time I checked, the man after God's own heart was a radical worshiper. And David danced before the Lord with all his might. And I'm just telling you now, you don't have to be restrained. You can be free indeed, believe it or not. So we might as well go ahead and turn up. It's Friday night. You're here now. You're here now. You might as well turn up and praise the Lord and get delivered and get full of the Holy Ghost for real. Hallelujah. So tonight, I'm here to turn up with you. But as I was seeking the Lord, he again gave me this threefold assignment, and that is to, number one, affirm the man of God. Now, this is not something that is necessarily commonplace, but the Bible says that we ought to give honor to whom honor is due. And I've had an opportunity to just be a friend and a brother to your pastor, Pastor Carl, for these last few years, and many times he's called me or texted me or emailed me And I'm not the best at getting back right away. But nonetheless, he's bore his soul to me. He shared his burden with me that he was struggling. Has anybody struggled? You ever felt like you were giving up? Or you even gave up and God got you back up and kept you going? And I've had a chance to, as his brother, allow him to just be vulnerable and transparent with me and just to hear his heart. And my heart has been moved that he has kept on going. And so I'm here to say to you, brother, man of God, pastor, chosen by God, appointed by God, anointed by God, commissioned by God, well done. You're doing excellent. You're doing excellent. The devil has failed. The devil has failed. You are further along than you should be if the enemy would have had his way. Don't you ever listen to another voice of accusation that tells you that you're doing this wrong or that wrong. You put your faith in God, keep going. And for the people who serve this ministry, well done as well. Hallelujah. You can't do it by yourself. I know Bishop Turner, I know you know this after your many years in ministry. You've been blessed, I'm sure, with many faithful people to serve alongside of you. Elder Bishop Mathis, you know you can't do it alone. So hats off to everybody here who's been serving and giving and supporting. And I want to encourage you by the word of the Lord, keep supporting and giving and establishing this ministry. God does not raise up a ministry just because there's a need for another ministry. Whenever God raises up a ministry, it's so that God can bring about salvation and deliverance for the souls of men. That's why the voice was raised up, to be a voice that cries out, prepare ye the way of the Lord. God did not raise up a ministry just to take up space on the street corner. He's raised up this ministry, and he's called the people here, and he'll call many more in the days to come. We're believing God for a great harvest of souls and also for willing workers that will come and serve the vision of a voice that cries out. And so from the Lord, as your brother from Ohio, be encouraged and keep going. And now the proclamation of the word of the Lord. As I was seeking the Lord, he dropped this scripture in my heart. If you would, turn your Bibles to Psalm chapter number 51. Amen. But Psalm chapter 51, many people, if you're a Bible student, you know this as David's prayer after he had sinned with Bathsheba. And we're going to jump down to the latter part of this psalm. And I want to direct your attention to verses number 16 and 17. Amen. They stand at this place. I just seen your pastor stand, so amen. I was a little nervous saying that. I said, I don't know how they do it at the voice, but amen. We do that back in Hope City. We love to honor the word of the Lord. Amen. Tonight, I'll be reading to you from the New King James. I left my King James at home on accident, but tonight it will suffice. Amen. But beginning in verse number 16, the psalmist cries out. He says, for you do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it. You do not delight in burnt offering. Verse 17, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a broken and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Tonight, I want to speak to you from this subject, the beauty of a broken heart. Uh-oh, I was hoping for some amens. The beauty, it might sound like an oxymoron or like a phrase that does not fit well, but tonight, the word of the Lord, the beauty of a broken heart, subtopic, how God solves problems. How God solves problems. Hallelujah. We live in a culture which is full of iniquity. In the days of Job, it refers to those people who drunk down iniquity like water. Jesus talked about the day prior to his coming. He said that as it was in the days of Lot, the days of Noah, it will be the same exact way in the days prior to the coming of the Son of Man. And if you know anything about Bible history or world history for that matter, you look back to that time period, you see the Bible says that the thought of man was continually wicked, that there was always evil in the heart of man. You look at the days of Lot, men were so perverted that they wanted to have sex with angels. Now, we think it might be a little bit odd for a man to want to lie with a man or a woman to lie with the woman, but could you imagine the state of godlessness if a holy angel of the Lord walked in this place and perversion was so deep in your heart that you wanted to seduce the angel of God? Could you imagine a culture that did not fear God to that extent? Could you imagine a people that were so stubborn and rebellious and so anti-Christ in their heart and anti-Christ in the way they thought and so rebellious in their nature that they would lie with an angel? And God has to destroy that city of Sodom and Gomorrah. And then Jesus says exactly how it was in that day. It's going to be that way the days prior to the days that I come. He didn't say, when I come the first time. I'm not talking about the story of Christmas. I'm talking about the second coming of Christ. How many of you are ready for Jesus to come again? To establish his kingdom on the earth. To sit on David's throne. Hallelujah. And he says, before that glorious reign of the new Jerusalem, heaven on the earth, the kingdom come, before that day, there's going to be such a high amount of sin and iniquity and rampant lawlessness all over the world. But yet in that climate of sin, God's going to raise up a solution. So you might be wondering, how does God fix a problem? And I was reading a quote the other day. Somebody asked Billy Graham, they said, if Christianity were true, why is there so much evil in the world? Have you ever had a person who was either atheist or agnostic ask that question? If God is all powerful, if God is all loving, why is there so much evil in the world? Billy Graham answered the question. He said, there's so much soap in the world, yet there's still dirty people. And the point was that you must apply the soap to the dirt to be cleansed. So we can look at the fact that God is all powerful and all knowing and all wise and blame him. Or we can look at ourselves and we can say, God, have mercy on me. Because the problems of the world are the problems of people. It's not God's fault. It's our fault. If I have a hammer, I can take that hammer and I can nail a beautiful piece of art on the wall. And you can walk in and be amazed by it. Or I can take that same hammer and go and bash somebody's brains out. The problem isn't the hammer. The problem is who's holding the hammer. And so while this whole world has aimed its accusations against God, this whole world is finding arguments and things that exalt themselves against the knowledge of God, God has a solution. God has a solution. I'm going to say it three times. Let it be established. God has a solution. Tonight, I'm going to go through a few problems. There are many more problems, but these are the main problems, and this is where tonight we'll find understanding from the word about how God is going to solve them. The number one problem is the problem of sin. Now you're saying, of course, Jesus Christ died on the cross. He rose again. We just celebrated the resurrection. So the problem of sin should be ended. But the problem of sin, again, is the problem of each man or each woman. And that's why, again, I feel like I'm quoting Billy Graham multiple times tonight, but he said Jesus didn't die for all, but for each. Meaning that each man must deal with this issue of sin, this problem of sin. Now, payment has been made, and I'm here to rescue somebody. The payment has been made. All of the guilt and all of the shame and all of the condemnation that is on your life right now by one sacrifice of one man once and for all, you have been cleared if you would but put faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. The problem of sin can be solved if men would but repent. If men would turn from their wicked ways and turn to the living God and confess him as Lord and surrender their life to him and be filled with the Spirit of God and give him everything, then in one moment, generational curses could break off of you. In one moment, drug addiction could be done away with. In one moment, spirits of homosexuality and perversion could be cast out of you. In one moment, it doesn't take God 10 years or 20 years or 2,000 years to solve the problem of sin. All God needs is somebody to surrender in one moment. The problem of sin is solved by a surrendered heart. And tonight I'm talking about the beauty of a broken heart. So what leads a man or a woman to that place called repentance is when God hedges you in with thorns in your life or your circumstances get so difficult that you don't have anywhere to look but up and you have no one to call on but God. And in that place of broken, this ain't going. In that place of finding out that no matter how much money you have or how many struggles you have, there's nothing that can satisfy you. In that place of revelation that you need a Savior, that's where you can be set free. But too many of us, we live so free and we live so light, lackadaisical, and we don't realize our need for God. So we believe with our mouth, but we don't believe with our life. And the problem of sin still rages. And so you got church people coming to church and they sing the song and they say amen, but they go right back to the pornography. They go right back to the love of money. They go right back to the spirit of religion. They go right back to the bar stool. They go right back to fornication, right back to adultery, right back to jealousy, right back to witchcraft, right back to you name the vice. But if the problem of sin is going to be solved, God has to break your heart. God has to break your heart. Has anybody been broken by God? And when he breaks us, he doesn't do it to spite us. Some of you tonight, you feel broken and you feel weak and you feel like you don't have strength to press on. That's the mercy of God trying to wake you up that there's only but one that can mend the brokenhearted. There's only one name that you can call on. You may get a tax refund and pay off a bill, but yet you're still dealing with the problem of sin. You might find the man or the woman of your dreams and fulfill your romantic desires, but you're still dealing with the problem of sin. And so God will get you in a place where you are so confined, and he will break you. When God wants to solve a problem, he breaks a man. Because listen, here's the thing. God only uses broken things. If you're all well together, put together, then God can't use you. As long as you're self-sufficient and feeling like you got it going on, God can't use you. Because when God uses you, then you would get the glory and you would take the credit. So God takes the foolish things of this world to confound the wise and to put them to shame. He takes people like our Pastor Carl, who used to be bound by that perverted spirit, and now he preaches holiness and righteousness, and the devil can't do nothing about it. And I don't know what your testimony is, but I know if you have a praise, then you have a testimony. You see, praise is the evidence you've been delivered. When you come in church and people, you have to beg people to praise, beg people to worship, beg people to pray. People get annoyed when you ask them to stay on their feet. You have not been delivered. Because when you've been delivered, you can't be quiet about it. When you've been delivered, you can't sit still. And so that's why God had to break you to make a worshiper out of you. And that's what God has done. That's what God has done in Pastor Carl's life and in many of your life. He's done it in my life. I'm not speaking to you as somebody that came out the womb speaking in tongues. I'm thankful for my godly heritage, but each man must deal with this problem of sin. My mom and my dad's confession of faith in the 70s can't save me in 2014. Your praying grandmother might have hedged you in, but she can't stand in the gap for you and deliver you herself. So God breaks people. When God wants to solve the condition of society, the sin that abounds, he has to find a man or a woman. He said in the word of God, I look for a man. He's looking for a man who would stand in the gap, who would make up the hedge, who would stand there and as it was, as Moses did, and plead, oh God, have mercy. All throughout the scripture, as Daniel did, oh God, have mercy. As Nehemiah did, oh God, have mercy. You go through all the prophets as Jeremiah did. Oh, God, have mercy. Oh, God, have mercy as Paul did. I'm groaning till Christ be formed in you. Whenever God finds a man, he breaks that man and he puts the groan in that man. And then God can begin to work. This first year, perhaps the next year, even maybe the next year after that, I don't know. But God is in the process of breaking this people. God is in the process of breaking the inhabitants of this city and this state. Because there has to be a cry from the remnant. And see, when life is cushy, you don't have praise. But let your money get funny. Let your life go awry. Then suddenly you become a most radical worshiper in the world. But I just have news for you tonight. God's not looking for crisis intercession. He's not looking for people that suddenly, all of a sudden, when life is tough, now they want to praise. He's looking for the worshipers that would worship him in spirit and in truth. And so God fixes problems, because when God breaks a man's heart, when God begins to heal that man's heart, just like Jesus, now he's able to minister with compassion. See, if you've never gone through anything, then you are not able to reach the unreachable or touch the untouchable. If you just came out and your life was always perfect, you would quickly be like those Pharisees did and just walk past that guy on the side of the road. But then this good Samaritan comes along And he comes and he bandages up his wounds, but this guy doesn't even know who God is. But yet he was a man that was acquainted with that other man's suffering. So when God wants to solve a problem, he's got to put you through suffering. So for all the things you've gone through this past year, all the things that you've gone through in the prior years to this, all it was doing was preparing you for the harvest that you're getting ready to reach. If you would have never had to have a financial struggle, you would never have a word for that single mom that comes to you with her financial struggle. If you never had that feeling to give up and quit, you would never have that compassion for that heroin addict that wants to give up and go back to the needle. And so God puts you through these things. He breaks you. And that's why I say tonight, it's beautiful when your heart is broken. Don't always blame the devil when stuff goes wrong, because wrong ain't always wrong. Y'all don't hear what I just said. Wrong is not always wrong. It might look wrong, but it is perhaps the will of God. I'm sure if you think about the story of Joseph, he was sold into oppression and captivity by his own brothers. He was accused of falsely raping the wife of Pharaoh, or Potiphar rather. And then you got all these people in Scripture who their life, Abraham, you could go through the whole list of people who it seemed the circumstances went wrong. But it was God. It was God. It was God. It was God who allowed it. It was God who causes all things to work together for the good of those that are called according to his purpose. You know why the devil wants you to quit? You know why the devil wants to snipe out people? I was telling him, I said, you know, when Hope City first started, some people look at that ministry now, you know, he just testified about how it's blossomed and grown, and it has, to the glory of God. But I'll just be honest with you, probably I would say 70% of those people who were there in that first year are nowhere to be found now. Now, some of them went on to other ministries and we blessed them. But a good deal of those people left with a bad spirit. A good deal of those people went out the door talking bad about us. Some of the people walked in there and they didn't like that convicting message and they thought this and they thought that, so they left. Some people can't handle the fire. See, if you've been called to change things, then you always are going to go against the grain, and you will not be able to fit in with the status quo. Listen, God did not raise up this ministry. He didn't raise up the Voice ministry to be another church at all. This is not a good career choice if you're trying to make money or do something great. This is a ministry choice or a career choice that belongs to those that believe in the eternal. And so, yes, for every one person that left, God in his perfect timing brought five to replace them. So we know that at the end of the day, God will get the glory. But here's the truth. Sometimes God doesn't replace them. Sometimes you finish with less than what you began with. And that's why God has to break your heart. See, the Apostle Paul, he was the greatest evangelist of his earlier days. He was known. He had a reputation. He was doing miracles. He was throwing his handkerchief on people and devils were getting cast out. But then toward the end of his life, many of his closest ministry partners have forsaken him. Many of his churches are full of corruption. And I could imagine the Apostle Paul looking at himself like, what did I do wrong? Did I blow it? Why didn't the church grow in holiness like I prayed for, God? Why didn't they follow the example that I modeled with my life? Why, when I came to them in weakness and I came to them and I asked nothing of them, did they accuse me falsely, God? And what he didn't realize maybe, or what he did realize, and I believe he did realize, is that God was breaking him. Because now, why? Because when we need inspiration and we need encouragement, who do we read? You don't read the people that lived the perfect life, that got it all right, that never had problems. You go to the man that struggled and went through some stuff, right? And then you find strength. And then you're able to get up again and keep going. So I come to affirm you. Count it all joy. The Voice, count it all joy. There is a hereafter. And our effectiveness in ministry is not based on how many people come or go. It's not based on how much the offering totals are. It's not based on how many speaking engagements or how big and fancy your name gets. It's about, did you do your job? And I say to you, man of God, you have done your job. You're doing your job. And by the grace of God, you will continue to do your job. God will help you. God will help this people. The next problem, and I'm getting to it. Be with me tonight. The next problem that we need to deal with that God is solving in this generation, and this is particular in the church, and that is the problem of powerlessness. 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 We are many times, I wouldn't say everybody, because that's I don't like to generalize, but by and large, there's a great majority of people who have a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. There's a problem. You got to, first step to solving the problem is realizing you got a problem. This is an individual question. Do you have the power of God in your life? Do you have the unction to pray? Do you have oil in your lamp? Do you have spiritual strength to resist the devil? Or every single time temptation comes, do you yield and bow your knee to that spirit of temptation? In the church today, when you see rampant sin, I'm talking about in the church, not the world. When you see competition and jealousy and all sorts of scandals, TV shows that glamorize it. We have a problem of powerlessness. So how does God solve the problem of powerlessness? Again, he finds that man or that woman who's willing to be broken. Because before you can receive the true, genuine, indwelling baptism of the Holy Spirit, you must be broken. The scripture we read from, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. God cannot anoint, God cannot set fire to a profane or an unholy sacrifice. So God breaks you, and sometimes you get confused, and again, we believe that it's the devil all the time. Could it be that God is trying to anoint you in a greater way? Because I tell you, in the places around this world where God is moving powerfully, and it's obvious because people are coming out of wheelchairs and blind eyes are being opened, and the miracles we read about are happening, you don't find mega churches in those places. You don't find famous preachers in those places. You find poor and needy people in those places. You find people that are so given to prayer, so given to fasting, that are so willing to do whatever it takes, the people who will really love their lives, not even unto the death. And those are the type of people that God can use and move through his power with. And that's the type of people that God's trying to raise up in Delaware. Suffering. Suffering produces the power of God. You notice this, you know, if you really have a prayer life, you notice that your most powerful prayers are not really the energetic, high-powered, like loud ones. That might make y'all think that the person is powerful, because that's real easy. All you got to do is be at church long enough and learn how to do that. But see, when you hear all that noise, it's not saying it's always noise, but because God definitely does use that as well. But what I'm saying is some of the most powerful prayers come through people who are on their broken place, in their weak place, in their insignificant place, their obscure place. God, why do you keep bypassing me? It seems like I'm never going to get out of this. Oh, but God, I trust you. And when you get to that place, when you run out of eloquence and you run out of rhetoric, and all you do is say, God, help me. God, have your way. God, move in my life. God, please rebuke the devil. God, do whatever it takes, and your prayers get simple. That's when you get powerful. But God has to break you. So see, I've learned, I've been doing this now. I got ordained as a pastor in 2009, so it's been a little over 5 years. And what I learned really quickly was that if I'm going to be used greatly by God, I must be crushed greatly by God. I've got to put my heart on the altar and say, God, crush that heart. God, take out of me the heart of stone that is impenetrable, and God, give me a heart of flesh. Because God, I know that it's right to pray for the issues on your heart, but God, I'm not weeping over lost souls. I know that that's the buzzword to pray. Oh God, save souls. But God, something inside of me does not move when I think about souls being saved. Something inside of me does not move when I think about the reality of the lake of fire. So God, would you please burden me with the revelation of eternal judgment? When was the last time you heard a preacher preach on the lake of fire? And furthermore, when was the last time you heard a preacher preach on the lake of fire with tears streaming down their face? Everybody wants to talk about Jeremiah. Jeremiah was a man that wept. He was grieved in his heart. He was a true friend of God. His heart was broken. But the scripture says that's the type of sacrifice that's pleasing to God. When you get alone with God, listen, we have a prayer meeting on Friday nights. There is usually now upwards of 100, 150 people coming every Friday night. And we're praying for things such as, you know, the issue of abortion. We're praying for human trafficking. We're praying for lost souls. We're praying for Israel. We're praying for all these grand and wonderful things. But the most amazing thing to me is that in the midst of those prayer meetings, I look across that front row or at that altar, and I see the same people who just 2-3 years ago were at the nightclub, 2-3 years ago were shooting up heroin, that were doing all the stuff that people do, weeping. See, it has to go beyond the form. And when you begin to take on the heart of God and the burden of the Lord, that's when God uses you powerfully. The prayers that avail much are the prayers that are accompanied with tears. I think it was A.W. Tozier who said that dry eyes reveal a dry heart. And if God is going to move, and he is moving, and he will move, but before God can greatly move in Delaware and in this ministry and in your life, there's got to be some rending of the heart. The prophet Joel, he warned those people through Joel. He said, rend your heart and not your garment. Don't come to me in pretense. Don't come to me with that form of church. Don't come to the church and go through your little prayer model in your brain, but actually rend your heart at this altar and say, God, if you don't move in Delaware, we are lost without hope. We are dead in our sin, and we need a Savior. That's the type of people that God is looking for. That's why God raised up the Voice Ministries that are broken, that have a broken and a contrite heart, that tremble at his word. When was the last time the word of God caused you to tremble? When was the last time you just looked at the Bible, you opened up the pages, and the fear of God came over you? And I'm telling you this not to boast, but there's times when my Bible will be sitting on my desk or my table, and I'll go to lean down, and I won't even put my elbow on it. I won't put it on underneath something. Not that I'm worshiping the book, but because I hallow the Lord and I esteem his word. My heart is trembling, and so that outward act is a result of how I feel. And I'm asking you tonight, do you feel that way about the word of the Lord? Have you gotten to that place of brokenness? Because that's how God solves the problem of powerlessness. He has to break you. Third problem, and this is where I come to the rescue, through the word of the Lord, where Jesus comes to the rescue, lest you misquote me. The third problem is the problem of unrighteousness. Unrighteousness. Do you understand that unrighteousness is not the same as imperfection? In your dictionary definition, that might confuse you. When we talk about righteousness, we're talking about something internal. We're talking about the soul condition. Perfection, that's outward. You can look the part. So there is a problem in our world, not the issue of how we look, but the issue of how we actually are, the issue and the problem of unrighteousness. How does God solve that problem? Well, we know that through Jesus Christ, through the blood that he shed on Calvary, he once and for all solved the problem of unrighteousness. There are people in this room tonight, and I tell you this by the word of the Lord, you have not been declared righteous by God. If you were to die tonight, you would spend eternity in the lake of fire. And you're analyzing in your own heart, how do you know that? And I ask you, how do you know not? How do you have blessed assurance that Jesus is yours? That you have truly been converted by the power of God? Are you wondering if you would spend eternity with God? The Bible says that whosoever name was not found written in the Lamb's book of life is cast into the lake of fire. And the Lord sent me here tonight. I don't know if it's 1 or 3 or 6 or 15. I don't know. But you have not solved the problem of righteousness or unrighteousness. The devil wants you to think that it's so difficult. You're thinking, well, maybe if I go to church every Sunday, every Wednesday, every Friday, every Tuesday, every Thursday, if I give more, dress better, clean up my act. No, you're dealing with perfection, looking the part. But the issue that is deep inside of your heart, the issue of righteousness, that sin-stained soul that can only be washed by the blood of Jesus Christ through faith in his name. God demonstrated his love toward us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While you were unrighteous, ungodly, unholy, unlovable, untouchable, unseeable. From the holy vantage point of God, that's when he sent his son in the fullness of time, at just the right time. Right when you came to the end of your rope, right when history was at that tent, that point, and it was about to flip over and the world was about to lose and spin out of control, that's when Jesus came. He didn't come at the wrong time, not 1 minute late, not 1 minute early, right on time. He showed up in our world. He split time in half. Before this latest, greatest atheistic invention, we know it as BC, before Christ, and AD, after death. They call it now before the common era, but I'm telling you, that's the work of the devil. Jesus Christ split time in half. He touched down on this planet. He split time in half at the perfect time to save you. There are people, I promise you this, as I heard it, it's clear in my spirit, as you hear my voice now, he said there are people who will be at that service tonight. They're trying to do well. They're coming forward. They're coming to church, but yet they have not truly surrendered their life. Surrendered your life. You haven't allowed God to break you. You have not allowed God to put you there and take the hammer of his word and crush you. But I tell you that in that crushing is the healing. In that breaking is the mending of your heart. In that place of being pulverized, brought to your wits end, is the place of being picked up and made new again. My testimony, grew up in the church, heard the gospel all my life, heard this type of message all my life. Grandparents, grew up in the church. I can look back, my family history is unlike Carl's. I knew nothing but God all my life. I remember feeling the presence of God at church. I was baptized in Jesus' name at 12. But why was I bound by sin? Why was I coming to church? I'm going to be honest with y'all, high off marijuana. Why was I coming to church as a teenager, hungover from the weekend partying? Why? Did I know if I put my suit on and if I say the right stuff and I go to the youth meeting and I do what my parents want me to do, then it'll be okay. They won't recognize it. Because no matter how many times I heard it, I had not received it. And that's what God is saying to you tonight. You've heard it, you've heard it, you've heard it, you've heard it, you've heard it. And you've been going around and around and around in this circle of confusion. And God wants to bring you to an end of confusion and unite you together with Jesus Christ. All you have to do is surrender this night. All you have to do is give your all to him this night. You don't have to leave this door the way you came in it. Some of you are tormented in the night by evil spirits. Some of you have dreams and you see demons and ghosts. I know I'm talking to somebody. Some of you, you walk and you feel fear. You walk into your house or your apartment. You go out to your car at night. You walk to your car after you get off work and you just feel shadows and you feel fear all around you. Am I talking to anybody? That spirit of fear haunts you. And I'm telling you, when you have truly been born again, when God gives you the Holy Spirit, when God imputes the righteousness of Christ upon you and you're washed in the blood, he rebukes fear. He rebukes death. He rebukes disease. He rebukes every single curse of sin. He solves every problem the moment you surrender to Jesus Christ. You don't have to carry the burden any longer. The Bible says, cast your cares upon the Lord, for he cares for you. Some of you are struggling in so many ways, and all you have to do is cast your cares upon the Lord, for he cares for you. That's the remedy, is to say yes to the Lord, to surrender to the Lord. Some of us, we're another group of people. We heard this so much. We said yes once upon a time. You know the definition of backslidden is when you can remember a point in your life when you once had more passion for Jesus. Most people think that backslidden is that you're in some active lifestyle of sin, that you must be out the club again, you must be getting high again. No, not necessarily. When you're backslidden, that means you're sliding back. In other words, the Bible word for that is lukewarm. You remember a time when you once had passion for God, but yet that oil has been leaking. And God wants to come and fill that void and plug that hole. And tonight, all you have to do is say yes. And here's the full gospel story. I'm not promising you that your life is about to be better than it's ever been. I'm promising you that you will have a peace that surpasses understanding, that you will have a joy that's inexplainable, that you will have a praise when you look like you have no reason to praise. That's what I promise you, that no matter what the enemy brings, no matter what life brings, you'll have blessed assurance in your soul. But if you're going through life and you're confused, or you feel this constant weight of oppression, you feel this constant just affliction in your soul, and you don't know where you stand with God, the Lord says, stop trying to figure it out and just say yes. Say yes again. There are men in this room bound by pornography. I'm not trying to be tough guy by telling you that. I'm telling you I've been delivered. That's part of my testimony. That God set me free. See, you might as well tell the truth and shame the devil. The things that once had me bound no longer. That's why I can expose it. That's how you know you've been delivered, when you can tell on the devil. And if you can't stand up and share your testimony of being delivered from whatever it is, you haven't been delivered yet. So I'm trying to tell you tonight, if you do not have a praise or a testimony, you can get one tonight. Now all you have to do is come to the Lord. Come to Jesus. Again, I think someone talked about the Facebook status that I put up the other day, and I was talking about how when I first said yes to Jesus, I said yes to Jesus. I didn't say yes to the calling to preach. I said yes to the Son of God. I said yes to his will. I said yes to his ways. I said yes to his word. I said, God, I trust you with my life. And that's all he ever asked for. He's not looking for you to turn into an overnight sensation or preacher or teacher or singer or anything grand. All he's looking for is a friend. And that's what he wants for you, your quality of life. You'll never know the true quality of life that God intended for you. You will always live paycheck to paycheck and be disturbed and feel oppressed until you become a friend of God, until you enter into that beautiful, broken place. See, this is what some of our modern preachers are lying to us about. They're telling us that the sufferings of this present age are temporary, or that when we come to Jesus, they end. And what actually happens is that they actually begin. Except for the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us. So we have this treasure in earthen vessels. And so what I'm calling you to, and what God wants to rescue you from, is a life of the mundane and enter into the eternal lifestyle, where everything you do is in light of the day when you will meet your Maker. Everything you think and everything you do in light of the day when you will see your King. And you live every single day for your wedding. I'm going to be married on July 18th. Praise God. Thank you. I thank the Lord in his perfect time. He's made that happen. But I tell you, the thing that I'm looking forward to, I'm not looking forward to the honeymoon. I'm not looking forward to even anything down the road. I'm looking for the day when we finally become one. And I can say she actually belongs to me. There's no more engagement, no more boyfriend, girlfriend. When we become one, when I don't have any more shields to put up, no more barriers, that she and I can truly enjoy each other. And that's the feeling that God wants you to know of him. Do you have that? Do you feel that close to God? Jesus said that in John 15, that I no longer call you servants, but call you friends. Because, here's the reason why, because a servant does not know. The servants don't know what the master's doing. They don't have a clue about the will of God. They don't have a clue about the heart of God. They don't have a clue about how God feels about Delaware. They don't have a clue. They don't know anything. But the friends, those are the ones who he shares his heart with. And once God breaks you, once God makes you beautiful in that secret place, then he enters into covenant relationship with you. And I'm here tonight to rescue you through that message. I want everyone to close their eyes and bow their head, and I want you to pray with me if you have a testimony.